Welcome you all for today's webinar session, followed by the valedictory of Wildlife Week celebration. And I welcome our director, Karunapriya Madam IFS. I also welcome our Deputy Director, Ma'am, Kanchana Madam IFS. And I also welcome our veterinary doctor, today's speakers of the day, Dr. Daya Shekhar, Veterinary Officer of Aranjarana Zoological Park, Dr. Manimoli Sir, Biologist of Aranjarana Zoological Park. As a speaking guest, we got Ganesh Sir over here. Sir is a Deputy Director and Scientist of Chennai Snake Park. So without further delay, I request our Deputy Director, Madam, to present the keynote of today's session.
Good afternoon to all and all. On behalf of our director, Aranjarana Zoological Park, I take the privilege to welcome our speakers today. Today, on part of Wildlife Week celebration, we are conducting this webinar of three important sessions, that is more practically oriented what we are coming across nowadays, dealing with the urban wildlife. Actually, we the human being, we are living with in harmony with, we should live in harmony with nature. Day to day, on daily basis, we are coming across a lot of wildlife. That includes birds, which are it is visiting on daily basis. Because of the habitat which are available in the urban area, lot of food species, food shelter, and the fruit-bearing trees found along the avenues. Because of these opportunities, we are seeing lot of wildlife. Even nearby reserve forest areas also, some of the spotted bees are coming out in search of food and water. And we are coming across many birds. All those things happening because of this plenty of availability of the food source. And then mainly these wildlife are facing certain challenges, certain threats in terms of habitat, once they are coming out of their natural habitat, they are getting lot of risk in terms of fed by human beings, unnatural food. Example, monkeys we are seeing in many places, many divisions, forest divisions. A lot of visitors, they are feeding the monkeys. Bypassers are feeding the monkeys. So in turn, they are losing their natural food searching habitat. So that is one challenge. Another thing, they are exposed to unnatural food. Then apart from that, they are also getting a lot of plastics into their systems, because being roaming around in the urban setup, they are exposed to a lot of plastic pollution. Also, we are also coming across so many postmortem of animals in which plastic bags are traced in their stomach contents, intestinal contents. Then, many wildlife reptiles also coming out. Sometimes it is entering into the habitat, and there it is getting the risk of getting killed by the animal, killed by the human beings intentionally, because of the fear factor. Another thing is roadkill. So these are the major challenges faced by the wildlife of urban setup. So we are in a position to address these issues in order to conserve the wildlife in larger perspective. And also one more aspect I would like to highlight in this session is that at many places these animals are losing their homing range out. From one place to another place, it is traveling, and we are coming across many wildlife seizures in the airports, railway stations, and other things. They are being smuggled from one part to another part, and we are taking rescue aspects. So in this case, a lot of unwanted things, or a lot of threats in terms of roadkill, in terms of giving unnatural food, and then getting killed by road accidents, incidentally, and intentional killing by human being because of the fear factors. All those things we have to address, and we have to spread the message of conservation across the country in order to save the wildlife. I think in this session, in this webinar, we are having three speakers. They will be addressing the urban wildlife, and then the speaker from Snake Park also, Ganesan sir, is there. So the reptile aspects he will be covering. Our zoo veterinarian also will be covering certain aspects. So I think this session will be a more insightful, and we can carry more points, home away points for out of this session. I thank Sankari for giving me the opportunity, and I think with this I can end my speech. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a delightful talk, and you have emphasized about the man-made action that threatens the wildlife. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining today's session, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. And so as part of Wildlife Week celebration, Arunachala Zoological Park is keep organizing various events and contests throughout this week. And today is the last day of Wildlife Week. So we have planned for a webinar session focusing on urban wildlife. As majority of the participants who have joined today's session are from the urban areas, so we would like to focus the challenges faced by the wildlife in this urban setting. As a first speaker, we have Dr. Manimoli sir. He's a senior biologist of our Arunachala Zoological Park who has over 36 years of experience as a field biologist in our zoo. And sir has published over 40 research papers and articles on wildlife conservation and behavior management of animals, etc. And sir has been a mentor for students from PhD background, and sir is guiding our students from internship students as well. So now I take privilege to welcome Dr. Manimoli sir to talk on the topic urban wildlife and overview.
Good afternoon, viewers. It is my pleasure to present the urban wildlife conservation and overview. Okay, today, you know, majority of the wildlife which are staying and living in urban areas. So people, you know, might have witnessed so many orders like aves, reptiles, mammals, insects which will come to your home backyard, maybe a garden or the urban area playground, so on. Okay, let me first talk about the urban wildlife. You know, they also need to be protected, you know, and the restoring wildlife in our cities and the suburbs is a vital component of wildlife conservation. And conservation is not only in the forest. The people who live around the city, you also see a lot of wildlife around you that everyone should take care of them. Our urban wildlife habitat can support habitat connectivity within the ecological landscape and serve as a refuge for species impacted by urbanizations. Not only that, it also promotes the urban green space program that provides the public and local opportunity to wildlife in an open space, which will help limit use of more natural areas outside urban centers. So it will encourage the urban residents to appreciate and engage the outdoor activities. Moreover, it also encourages the biophilia. Biophilia is nothing but it's a love to animals and a connection to nature. So every people, they can themselves connect with nature by seeing this wildlife. Then apart from that, there are a lot of public parks and open space, not only increase the habitat and the connectivity for urban wildlife, but also expose people to nature in their own backyards. So the urban animals also regulate and support the ecosystem of towns and the cities. The ecosystem, you know, even urban areas, you can find a lot of ecosystem, maybe a pond ecosystem or a grassland ecosystem, which attract more wildlife. That creatures are as important things, maybe as a predator or pest. For example, some birds help to control the insect population. Certain predatory birds help to rodent control. It is most obvious reason for conservation is to protect wildlife and promote biodiversity. Protection of wildlife and preserving it for future generation also means that the animals we love do not become our distant memory, and we can maintain a healthy and functional ecosystem. So the urban area people also playing a major role in conservation of wildlife. Okay, in the urban areas, the essential component for wildlife, you take, you know, food, water, cover and space. These are the four components which require for any wildlife, maybe in forest or in the urban areas. Maybe I will talk about this topic one by one later. So you can witness so many wild animals in urban areas. You take an example of leopard. Leopard are the most adapted wild animal and learn to live with the humans in urban Mumbai. You know, there is a lot of conflict going on in Mumbai between people and leopards. Like that in North India, you can find a lot of rhesus macaques in the residential area and urban areas, and also highways, highway roads. Similarly, wild elephants, snakes, black eye, grey langur, common mongoose, palm, civet, there are so many things. If you take our South India, the bonnet macaque, you know, now it become an urban animal. You know, it's having a lot of problem in the urban areas. So here I am showing some of the wild animals which are living in urban areas, like horned owl, barn owl, white-throated kingfisher, then rose-ringed parakeet, palm squirrel, rhesus macaque, bonnet macaque, some civet cats. There are so many snakes. I am showing here some of the representative for each order: the calotes, lizards, turtle and tortoise. These all you can come across in urban areas, either in your backyard or in a public park. So the challenges and the opportunity for urban wildlife is manifold. Cities across in the country are home to variety of wildlife species. In addition to the species, you see every day many more are present but are active only at night. You know, many people, in the urban people, they may not witness the nocturnal animals and birds. They are all active during night hours. For example, owls and civet cats, so on, they are all nocturnal animals. Many species of urban wildlife receive little attention from homeowners. Okay, you know, many of them not witnessing, though it live in your garden or your backyard. They are present in such numbers that they become part of our everyday life. Often times we actively promote the presence of wildlife near us for personal or aesthetic purposes. millions of people put out bird feeders to attract wildlife to their backyards. Yeah, that's happening everywhere in the city. For example, maintaining an intimate contact with the wildlife in this way helps humans to retain a sense of their interconnection with the natural environment. This is one way we can promote wildlife. In some cases, however, the interaction of wildlife is a uni-intentional and sometimes it is unwanted. Okay, any basic survival for wildlife, you know, it's a habitat. All wildlife species need four essential elements to survive. I already told you food, water, shelter, and space. Shelter must be adequate to protect the wildlife from predators and the environment. Similarly, space must be adequate for the wildlife to successfully rear their young ones. In addition to these four requirements, the spatial arrangement for these necessities must be in proper order. Otherwise, you know, they will not be useful for them. That is to say, the source must be within certain distance of each other so that animal can access each safely on daily basis. That is the, you know, these are the basic need for any wildlife, either it may be a urban or in wildlife sanctuaries. Yeah, let me first talk about food. In urban area or urban settings, food may come from various sources, including both intentional and unintentional. A variety of fruit trees and shrubs provide food throughout the summer. Depending upon the fruiting season, the plant, these food sources can lost into the winter. Most producing trees, like the nut producing trees, significantly supply our food for squirrels and various bird species. A number of wildlife species routinely sources for food throughout the average urban backyard. Greens from yard and gardens are eaten by the grasses and other small shrubs eaten by rabbit, as evidenced by significant rabbit population in most cities and towns. Similarly, bats are voracious consumer of mosquitoes, eating up 3,000 mosquito per night. So the bats, one way they are controlling the mosquito, and also it is taking its own food. Similarly, hundreds of insectivorous bird species readily consume any available insect, like grasshoppers, crickets, caterpillars, and so on. Similar to birds, there are so many mammals. They also predate insects and small mammals. There are pigeons tend to subsist improperly stored garbage or other food materials provided them. Crows are omnivores and eat almost anything, readily adapted to local conditions. Like that, there are so many animals, they are eating our backyard vegetation and also the discarded food items. Other natural resources of food for urban wildlife include other wildlife species. Some of them are predatory species, feed on other wildlife, like raptors, such as hawks, kestrels, falcons, hinds. They are highly successful predators in the environment and help control the population levels of their prey species. Like that, snakes also predators and eat various types of small rodents and birds. I'm not going to touch the garbhota things because there is another speaker, Dr. Kanesh, who is going to talk about the urban herpetology. So there are other artificial sources of food for urban wildlife include garbage and any other human propagated food sources. Wildlife species should not become accustomed to acquiring food from these sources. However, it is important to maintain the sanitary condition throughout the community to eliminate these food sources. So in urban areas, the people should not feed their discarded food or other food that will harm to the animals. You can promote the natural vegetation or natural fruit bearing seeds or natural propagation of insects that will help your urban wildlife. Next source is a water. There are many sources of water available in to urban wildlife. You know, there are fountains, puddles, ponds, and drainages, ditches provide accessible source of water for urban wildlife. In addition to these direct sources, many species acquire adequate water through consuming high in water content, such as fruits, berries, or by consuming any meat. So that way they can conserve water. Then the third source of water is water droplets on the plant, on lawns. After a heavy morning dew or immediately after a rain event, they will get the water. As a general rule, water is not a limiting factor in terms of urban environment suitably for wildlife. Then another is a cover or shelter. This is another important component for wildlife. You may surprise by many different sources of shelter for wildlife can find in urban environment. Wildlife species seek the cover for nesting, feeding, and rearing the young ones. Older and larger trees commonly used for as a home for number of species. It may be birds or mammals or reptiles. They live in cavities within the trees that provide good denning sites for so many animal species. You know, birds nest in cavities, can be found anywhere. They can gain access to enclosed structures such as holes in buildings or racks in building. Pigeon can be found at those sites that provide an area for perching while simultaneously protecting the bird from the other elements like predators. Other birds such as swallows construct the nest on the side of the walls or river banks under the use of building. Owls and civet cats will find adequate shelter anywhere they can conceal themselves from people and the daily activities of humans. Because they are nocturnal, their den sites are difficult to locate during daytime hours. Because, you know, their activities all during night hours, the people may not see their hiding places. In short, I would like to say urban settings provide hundreds of places that wildlife species can exploit as a source of shelter. As with water, urban wildlife population are not usually limited by scarcity of cover or shelter. So it is, you know, the cover and shelter is more adequate and it is also available in urban areas. Then another needed facility is space. Animal also need space to survive. You know, they will not be constrained in a small area. Overcrowding of species can lead to competition for available resources like water, food, or shelter. For this reason, only a specific number of animals can live productively in an area. This limitation is commonly referred as the carrying capacity of the area. So this carrying capacity is applied in all wildlife habitat, not only urban. The carrying capacity of any places, you know, that is playing a major role for any animals who can live in particular habitat. In urban area, space is the most challenging habitat requirement to manage because it is difficult. You know, you cannot find such a vast area for urban wildlife, if not impossible, to manipulate these resources. As general rule, urban wildlife do not require large amounts of space to survive. In contrast, farmland wildlife such as deer species and ungulates, they require expansively large area. So these four factors, you know, food, water, shelter, and space, these are the common, they are the main resource for wildlife, and also they are the limiting factors for wildlife. Okay, what attract wildlife to an urban settings? That is a very interesting question. Various factors draw wildlife to urban areas. For example, dense planting or evergreen shrubs and trees may attract large roost of flocking birds. Vegetation with dense foliage create an attractive roosting habitat for noisy and messy birds. Yeah, wherever you have a large trees like banyan tree or neem tree with a large crown, that definitely attracts flocking of birds, including water sources or ponds, intermittent or permanent in a landscape design, may attract number of undesirable species. For example, with the white-breasted water hen often take up residence in office park or residential area or Gulf courses and other urban cities associated with water. Even I am staying in a Urappakkam where there are a lot of apartments and layout plans without the buildings that filled with water. You can find a lot of water birds like white-breasted water hen, then kingfisher, and so many other birds which attract the pond is so small, it attracts the birds. Planting short grass turf in association with the water may be particularly attractive to the geese. This is not applicable to in Chennai, but there is wetland area where there are a lot of teals and ducks which attracted towards the urban area. As noted previously, the presence of geese often results in the fouling or walkways and recreation area, contamination of water with droppings and the damage of full turf from feeding. Yeah, this is another negative impact. A lot of birds take some large trees attracted by some fruit bag. That will defecate and it will make a foully smell. And even ponds, they attract a large number of water birds. Again, that will make a lot of unwanted smell, and that will make the dirty. Similarly, using plants that are palatable to deer can result in extensive browsing, damage to expensive landscaping, increased collision between deer and automobiles, and elevated potential for Lyme disease. Then fruit, berry, nut, and other food-producing plants attract wild animals. When then these plants are placed near airport, electric power station, and high traffic area there, therefore, they can endanger public health and safety. There is some of the birds which are real threat to flight. There was a project in a airport. There is a raptor study. They are spending a lot of money to avoid the birds from the runways. Okay, so these are some of the negative impact on urban wildlife. Then how to control them? There are certain species, they are prolifically breeding. It is, we should also control the urban wildlife population. One must manipulate one of the four habitat factors I described previously. Wildlife cannot survive unless their habitat needs are met. Now I told you, if one of these habitat requirement is absent, wildlife will either migrate to another area capable of providing their needs, or they ultimately die. Okay, I told you the four factors: food, water, space, and shelter. So these are I told you earlier, it's a controlling factor. If anything one missing, they will not stay there. Either they are forced to migrate, or it will die of predation or starvation, so on. For long-term wildlife management, habitat manipulation is far more effective than direct population reduction in areas that meet the species habitat needs, and animal population birth and the survival rate will increase, ultimately replacing losses caused by direct population reduction. The types of amounts and form of habitat attributes required by individual species differ. To effectively manage an individual species, one must consider the species specific habitat requirement of the species. Understanding the biology and the ecology of the species will increase your chance of either improving condition for the animal or deterring them from increase in their numbers. To gain insight into the requirements of an individual species, you may consult your local wildlife biologist and wildlife enthusiast. Moreover, habitat manipulation is not only the best tool for reducing number of particular species, it is also the most effective strategy for attracting wildlife to urban environments. Once you determine which of the desired species habitat requirement is absent, you can supply the missing element and provide a habitat conducive to the animal presence. In short, habitat manipulation is the key to managing wildlife population in urban and also in natural ecosystem. If you provide or eliminate any one of the four necessary factors, the population respond accordingly. That is the controlling of wildlife. Then what are the threats to our urban wildlife? That is another interesting thing. Some of the biggest threat to wildlife include illegal wildlife trap. You know, there are misuse people who can catch and, you know, they sell. Then habitat destruction and invasive species, pollution and climate change. These are common to all wildlife, but it's also applicable to our urban wildlife. Okay, the illegal trade is the fourth largest criminal industry in the world after drugs, arms and human trafficking. It is a fourth rank. So people, if you see anybody illegally doing, you can please approach the Deep Forest Department and you can inform them this is happening. One way you are helping the wildlife indirectly. Then habitat destruction, you know, the bulldozer pushing down trees, you know, that is happening in city. You know, now there are a lot of construction is going on. It may be a factory or housing or railways, you know, or expanding roads. So there we are, cutting a lot of trees. Otherwise, you know, people directly destroy habitat, include filling in wetlands, dredging rivers, moving fields and cutting down trees. So these are another factors which really, you know, matters in urban wildlife. Habitat destruction, fragmentation and modification caused by human leader activities. You know, this all, you know, produced by humans. That is industrial and residential development, logging, crop farming, livestock raising, mining, road and dam building, and, you know, pesticide zoos, so on, have taken an extreme toll on threatened and endangered wildlife population at the alarming rate, not only in the wildlife refuge, but also in the urban wildlife areas. Okay, then what can be done? There is a lot of laws in India. There is a Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which is giving a lot of protective themes or laws which will conserve our wildlife. Wildlife is held in the public trust by states and the federal government. No one entity owns the wildlife species. whatever you are keeping, you know, either it may be a lovebird or a snake or turtle, you know, everything is a offense. You know, nobody can keep any wildlife in their houses. States retain primary authority over resident wildlife. The ruling government of various nations agreed to cooperate in the conservation and management of those migratory wildlife species that move freely across common borders. Okay, that is, there is a, you know, agreement between countries to protect the wildlife. When considering a possible manipulation of urban wildlife species, it is vital to determine the legality of such action. When in doubt, always contact Wildlife Resource Agency for consultation. Anyone taking illegal action against wildlife species subject to the state or federal charges, please report to the Forest Department. They will take care of it. Regarding this, any injured or something happened, maybe in the next class, our veterinary officer will carry forward all your doubts which are having in your mind. Thank you very much. So everyone, please take oath on this Wildlife Week celebration day and conserve our wildlife. It may be you living in the forest or in your backyard or in your urban area or in your village. So I hope you all understand the problem right now we are facing in the urban areas. Please take care of wildlife. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for a very informative session. And in this session, sir has covered about the various aspects of wildlife, like what actually wildlife does in the urban settings. So thank you so much, sir, for enlightening us. Next, we go on to the next speaker. Ganesh, sir, is a deputy director and scientist from Chennai Snake Park. And sir is specialist in wildlife biology from University of Madras. And sir is an eminent taxonomist who have discovered over 15 reptile species from South India. He has published over 100 articles and serves in an editorial board of many scientific journals. So most, if you think about the urban wildlife, most of the urban wildlife which is much affected or belongs to snake and amphibians, we feel proud to have you over here, sir, to enlighten us about the what are the snakes that we have in our country, and what are the amphibians and what are the threats they are faced by them, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for your invite.
Yes, sir. We'll be
Before I begin, we from the Chennai Snake Park
The voice is breaking, sir.
Yes, before we begin, we at the Chennai Snake Park feel happy and privileged to form part of the celebration activities headed by IASLP Zoo. Yeah.
So we can go ahead, sir.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Okay. We all know India is one of the most populous countries in the world, which has probably the second highest of world's population, next only to China. And we also know that this place has lots of cities, like urban centers, which are a growing and burgeoning conglomerate of cities after cities, like towns and towns, very big and humongous human settlements. And we also know that India is home to several biodiversity hotspots that are very rich in endemic radiation of biota, including flora and fauna, especially lower vertebrates such as reptiles and amphibians. We know that we have regions like the Western Ghats, the Eastern Himalayas, the Andaman Nicobar Islands, which offer a great deal to biodiversity in a global scale. So despite having these seemingly opposing features, on one hand, human presence, and on the other hand, a lot of wildlife, how do so much of wildlife and so much of people share the space and the resources amicably? And what are the consequences that's a kind of ensuing due to this interaction are certain aspects of what we would be looking at, focusing especially on the Coromandel coastal region geographically and on the reptile and amphibians taxonomically. Yeah, we could go ahead with the slide. Next slide, please. Right, so when we say reptiles, snakes form a good part of it. Almost 60% of most reptiles in India are snakes, right? They are that very diverse, and 70 of them are venomous within Indian limits. And when we say snakes, venomous snakes, we also talk about snake bites. That's one of the most pressing problems that persist in this region. And largely it happens due to this human snake conflicts and interactions. So that's a very, very, again, a relevant thing to talk about and discuss when we deal with aspects such as urban wildlife. So what quantum of this kind of fauna has been touched by recent scholarship? Like, we have one from Central India, we have one from Northeast India, and we have one from North India. So from several kinds of regions within India, we have studies that explain about the diversity and distribution patterns of amphibians and reptiles in and around the peripheries and the core areas of the select cities. So as far as Madras is concerned, what kind of animals that are reptiles and amphibians are found here? How do they look like? What are their characteristic features? What are their names and salient features? It is these that we are going to look at in the coming slides. Next slide, please. Right, so we deal with snakes first, and we begin with the non-venomous snakes. We have two groups of non-venomous burrowing snakes, which are worm snakes, the one in the bottom row, and the sand boas, Eryx, and Indotyphlops. So these two groups are non-venomous. They are the only group of snakes which can dig their own burrows. A lot of snakes tend to live in burrows, but it is these which can dig their burrow all by themselves. Other snakes have to depend on burrows dug by other creatures to crawl in and live there. So that's the difference. Among these, the worm snake, common worm snake, is parthenogenetic, which means they reproduce without a proper confirmed male in an asexual way. And the sand boas are also unique in their reproduction, in that, like vipers, they are live-bearing species. They directly give birth to living young ones. Next slide, please. Right, and then we move on to land snakes. This is the so-called typical snakes. We have a rat snake, the large growing, non-venomous, commonly seen snake of the city holds. And we also have smaller forms like the trinket snakes down below, and wool snakes on the top right, and kukri snakes on the bottom right. So it is these four major groups of snakes: the rat snakes, Tyas, trinket snakes, Coelognathus, wool snakes, Lycodon, and kukri snakes, Oligodon. So these four groups of snakes are the major non-venomous land snakes that are found in and around city fringes in Madras. So we have different kinds of activity patterns, different kinds of size ranges as far as their total length is concerned, as well as different kinds of complications with respect to being lookalikes for venomous snakes. All these things complicate the interaction with these snakes and human beings. For example, the non-venomous wolf snakes are often killed as they are mistaken for crates because of their dark body with light bands. We'll look at the crates in a few more slides to come. So then it would be clear why people mistake this species with that one. And the same goes with rat snakes. They're often mistaken for cobras, but they are different. So it is these subtle things which often mislead people into thinking one kind of snake into other. And even non-venomous snakes are often irrationally killed by people because of such attitudes. Next slide, please. And then we move on to water snakes. We have three kinds of water snakes in the freshwater bodies. They are called as keelbacks because they have a strongly keeled scales, giving it a very rough texture and appearance. All the scales have a kind of fold which enables the snake to crawl and swim properly in marshy areas, wetlands and watery substratum. We have the striped keelback with the top left with two prominent yellow parallel stripes, and the olive keelback in the top right, that's olivaceous green or bottle green above and lemon yellow beneath. And we also have the most common and highly defensive species, the large growing checkered keelback water snake, which is in the second row in the center. So these species are predominantly fish eating snakes. They also eat frogs, especially the striped keelback. It prefers frogs over all kinds of other prey. And they live in several types of wetlands like lakes, ponds, even inside wells, inside sumps, inside tanks. And in all these places, we get to see keelback water snake, especially the checkered keelbacks. So in natural conditions, in near natural settings, like in rice paddies and fields, cultivated lands, whenever there is a stagnant water body nearby, we have crabs settling there, and crab holes are favorite hiding places for the checkered keelback and other kinds of water snakes. Many of them estivate or go for a summer sleep during the dry months or the hot weather. And when the rains appear, they again come out of their lairs and start their activities. Next slide, please. Right, and then there are tree snakes. Two species are non-venomous snake, whereas one, the cat snake, that's in the second row, is mildly venomous. Mildly venomous snakes are those which have toxic saliva that are powerful enough to subdue and kill the intended prey species. It is completely inconsequential if a bite to happen to a human being. That is the definition for mildly venomous snakes. Their fangs are solid, not hollow, and they are set in the rear of the jaw, of the upper jaw, just below the eye or further away from that. That's how they differ from the typical front-fanged venomous snakes such as cobras and vipers. We have three groups, as I told you, the bronzebacks, so Dendrolaphis, vine snakes, genus Ahetula, and cat snakes, genus Boiga. These three kinds of tree snake occur in these landscapes, and they are medium-sized to large species, like they range from around 2 to 5 feet in length, and they have very slender, sleek, and elongated body that would enable them to properly climb onto tiny twigs and branches. That's an adaptation for climbing. They're found mainly in thorny trees and bushes because thorns offer a kind of protection from, say, for example, grazing animals or other kinds of animals, which like herbivores, right? So two species are dayactive, that is the bronzeback and the green vine snake, whereas the cat snake is active during the nighttime. And all these animals prey on species such as lizards, frogs, and birds. There are lots of myths told and retold by educated lot, especially regarding the green vine snake. People believe that it peck out people's eyes, but that's not the case. It's just a false allegation, it doesn't do like that. Just because it has pointed snout tip, people wrongly mistake that the snake will peck out people's eyes. It doesn't do that way at all. They also believe that bronzeback tree snake is venomous and that it will climb onto a tree after biting a person and wait for the smoke to come out from the funeral pyre of the victim. All these fancy stuffs are false and superstitious beliefs. Nothing of that sort happens in nature. Next slide, please. Right. Now we come to the venomous snake group, the big four venomous snakes: cobras, krait, Russell's viper, and saw-scale viper. Right. These four snakes are together responsible for, or together can be attributed for, a lot of snake bite that is happening in our country. Many of the times, when untreated, the people sadly die, and snakes are also getting killed by people because whenever they encounter or run into human conflict, many a time the casualties occur on both the sides, on part of snakes as well as on part of people. So it is these four species which are venomous snakes, and it is these four species that whose anti-venom serum is commercially available for medication in government hospitals in our country, right? And it is these four species which any lay person in India has to be quite wary of. And as far as the peripheries of Madras is concerned, we have wild population of all these four species represented or inhabiting the entire peripheral areas of Madras city. The salient features of some of them are that cobras prefer to live in rice and paddy fields, and sometimes in granaries, and kind of any bushy patch to escape the plow near farmlands is a good habitat for snakes. Their chief prey is rodents, and that is why we have an inordinate density of these kinds of venomous snakes in farmlands, because of the prey base that it supports, the rodent population. The next snake is the krait. The krait has a lustrous black body with white cross bars across. It is completely active during nighttime, not to be seen out during day. Its venom is extremely toxic, very painless, no symptoms, very misleading. People don't even know that they have had a snake bite. Unfortunately, they just don't recover. They slip into coma, or they just die out of respiratory paralysis. And then we move on to vipers. The larger one is the fat and bulky Russell's viper. The smaller snake is the saw-scale viper that grows to only a feet or so in length. Both these vipers are called as pitless vipers or true vipers, and they have a viviparous reproductive mode, that is, they give birth to living young ones directly without laying eggs. And vipers are all like krates. These are night active species. When compared to cobras and krates, vipers, both these species, are less likely to share lands with human habitation. They are more fond of residing in vegetated areas or relatively unspoiled and pristine kind of habitats when compared to the cobras and krates. Next slide, please. Right, from snakes, we move on to lizards. The first group of lizards that we look at is the gecconid lizards, geckos. All of them belong to one single genus, the Hemidactylus, night active species. They are found in building walls, on trees and other structures. They all lay eggs, they feed on insects, and we often get to hear their loud chirping calls. So this group of animals, these geckos, they are very, very vital in controlling insect pest population in urban gardens and households. Even in our own building walls, in our own houses, near about tube lights, or whenever there is a source of light that is attracting a lot of insects, we always see these geckos that are just scrambling around nearby, waiting to feed on insects that throng there. Next slide, please. The next group of lizards are the garden lizards, chameleons, and monitor, many put together. Almost all of them are active during daytime. One species, the common garden lizard, is very common. Like, it's one of the most well-seen, well-sighted, and most well-known of all reptiles that are found in this region. While the other three species are all uncommon and rare, particularly the monitor lizard. But they do occur there. They are found in wild places just about the fringes of the city, as well as chameleons. They are also found. Fan-throated lizard is a very interesting kind of a lizard. It's very partial to open grasslands and open sand dunes, that kind of places, like near the beaches where we have beach sand. We have good population of hand-throated lizards, as well as in other areas that are either rocky or stony near about the hillocks, we have fan-throated lizards. So these are some of the agamid lizards and associated taxa that we get to see in and around Madras. Next slide, please. The next one is skinks. Skinks are very shiny scaled lizards. They like to bask in the sun. They are active during daytime, and they live mainly in leaf litter, on ground, and on all sorts of surfaces, but are strictly terrestrial species. Right? They are often found near houses and gardens. One species, the keeled skink, is one of the most well-known and well-seen lizards in our region. And they are also wrongly believed to be venomous, which is all false. No skink, in fact, no lizard in India has venom like a snake to begin with. So these are not venomous lizards. These are not like the Gila monster or bearded dragon that we get to see in America. Those are the venomous lizards. But none of our Indian lizards are venomous in that sense, especially these skinks. People have misconceptions about them. People fear them, loathe them, and even try to kill them if they get to crawl close to human beings, right? So these are in turn acting as important prey species for a lot of snakes that we previously saw in our slides. So that is one of the most important ecological roles played by lizards in and around the region. They serve as both predator and prey to a lot of species. Next slide, please. Ganesh,
sir.
Next slide, please. Yes. So from reptiles, we move on to amphibians. The first family of amphibians that we are going to discuss about is Buffonidae, toads, three species belonging to one genus, the Taphrinus, is represented in this region. One of them, the common toad, the top left corner species, that picture, right? That one is one of the most, perhaps the most frequently sighted amphibian in our region, the common toad, right? It can be instantly recognized by their rough and tuberculate skin texture, very warty and tuberculate kind of a skin, and it's active at night. And it's often found on walls of buildings and other structures, in fallen trees. It lays eggs in strings near the water bodies, and it's also feeding on insects. They call and breed during the rainy season. Whereas the other two kinds of toads, the dwarf toad to the right and the second row, the marble toad or the Deccan Peninsula toad, these are much rarer species, but those that have been recorded from nearby districts of Madras City. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. And then we move on to the microhylid frogs. This is the next family of frogs that are one of the most well represented families of frogs found in this region. Some of the smallest frogs in our country, previous slide please, some of the smallest frogs in our country belong to this family, the Microhyladidae or the small mouth frog, especially Microhyla ornata, the ornate mouth microhyloid frog that is just an inch, less than an inch long. The average size of adult frog is only that much. So that is one of the smallest amphibians of our country. And we also have the marbled balloon frog, Euprodon cystoma, which is one of the largest of the region's microhyloid frogs. They do not have an exposed tympanum or eardrum membrane, which is one of the identification characters for viewing this, or for identifying this group of frogs. Could we go to the previous slide, please?
Priyanka, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Priyanka, please play the previous slide, ma'am. Yeah.
I have changed it, ma'am.
So, as all amphibians, they are active during night time and they are found in houses, some of them gardens and grasslands. Grasslands are one of the most important habitats for certain frogs like the Euprodon cystoma, the burrowing frogs, and these are more or less terrestrial. They are feeding on insects and they make either shrieking or chirping type of calls during the monsoon rains to breed. Next slide, please. Ma'am, next slide, please. Yes. Then the only group of tree frogs or arboreal species of frogs that we have in our region is Polypodes maculatus, the common tree frog, often found during rains in and around the gardens on avenue trees and plants. Previous slide, please. So the common tree frog can be identified by its horizontal pupil. And then we move on to the grassland or marshland frogs. We have cricket frogs. Next slide, please. We have cricket frogs of the genus Minervaria, bull frogs that are very large and heavily built frogs of the genus Hoplobatrachus, and burrowing frogs of the genus Pyrotheca. So these groups of frogs occur in this region. And some of them are huge, like bullfrogs. They can grow to nearly a foot in length. And they are also very infamous for feeding on larger animals, including many kinds of vertebrates, like snakes, even venomous snakes, other frogs of their own kind. So cannibalistic behavior has all been recorded in the bullfrog. They are all night active. When we say amphibians, almost all of them in this part of India are active during night. And they are regularly seen in paddy fields, inundated farmlands, near the fringes of marshlands and the surrounding grasslands. One group of frog, the Spirotheca, is called as burrowing frog because to go for aestivation, this group of frogs, like, they burrow under the soil and remain inactive. And when it starts raining or during the cooler times of the year, they come out again out of their lair and become active. For a brief period, they do aestivate in certain parts of the country. Next slide, please. And then wetland frogs, like thoroughly aquatic species of frogs, typically characterized by fully webbed feet, like the feet of the ducks. These group of frogs are adept at swimming. They're always found only in water bodies, never far away from water. So this group of frogs are thoroughly adapted for an aquatic lifestyle and can be seen frequently in pond waters, lakes, and other kinds of water bodies. They are medium-sized to somewhat large in size, especially the green frog is much larger than the other frog, Euplectus cyanoplectus, the skippering frog. They're active during night. They call during night, especially during rainy nights for breeding. They live in wetlands and they are always partial to water bodies, as I told you previously. This is one of the indicator species for understanding the ecological fitness of wetland ecosystems. That the frogs are present in the kind of wetlands is a good enough proof for us to count on the water quality parameters or the general well-being of the wetland by and large. Next slide, please. Right, so indirect threats to all these fauna are more or less common to those of other animal groups as well. Habitat loss, fragmentation, edge effects, which means opening up of certain habitats or disturbing the vegetation structure of certain habitats to make way for any kind of human activities, such that the carrying capacity and the structural features of the habitat gets distorted. That's called edge effect. So near the peripheries of this habitat patches, there is an altered or diminished kind of faunal assemblage when compared to those at the center of the habitat patch. That's edge effect for us. And then several kinds of pollution or indirect threats. Our previous speaker, Dr. Manimodi sir, my senior sir, has given a very elaborate description of the habitat loss and fragmentation and threats. So I'm not elaborating on these things now. We go to the next slide, please. Direct threats, right? Wanton killing of snakes. People kill snakes out of fear. We all know this fact. This is actually one of the biggest problems facing all kinds of snakes living near human settlements, both venomous and non-venomous. So irrational fear and indiscriminate killing of snakes by people out of fear is one of the major factors that are causing a mass decimation of snake population world over. And still worse, some are determined to poach reptiles, like for example, turtles, monitor lizards, and a few kinds of amphibians are trapped and poached illegally by antisocial elements, which also have to be curbed. So it is these which are the direct threats to reptiles and amphibians. Next slide, please. Road kills. Snakes are perhaps the most well-represented fauna getting run over by vehicles when compared to, say, almost all groups of animals, especially vertebrate animals. More than any other groups, snakes are predisposed to being killed by vehicular traffic. So we have several disturbing records of roadkill instances in many of the roads near our towns and cities. So we have to drive wary and mindfully. And whenever we see snakes, it's good to navigate or brake or wait for them to move and then proceed. Next slide, please. Right, so we also have roadkill instances of turtles, frogs, and lizards, as well as venomous snake. For example, the Russell's viper or the common crate, even venomous snakes, people don't even recognize them as venomous and simply run over the snakes and they get killed by roads. Vehicle mortality is avoidable. It has to be avoided so that it also, it's a potential danger. Like for example, there are also chances for snakes giving a retaliatory bite, especially for two-wheeler riders. It's a risky thing if it happens to be venomous. So it's best not to pave way or create room for such kind of instances to happen in the first place. Next slide, please. So we are very much towards the end of the talk, and thanks for the opportunity that's given to me. And I just have one message to take it across. Help us conserve the amphibians and reptiles living next to us. Thank you on behalf of Chennai Snake Park.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ganesh, for joining today's session. And it was really an eye-opening session for us. We have learned about various facts and various key features of amphibians and reptiles. So thank you so much for joining our session in a very short notice, sir. So thank you so much for, we feel so happy to have you here today, sir. Thank you so much. And next, sir, we will move on to the next speaker, Dr. Dayashekar, sir. Dayashekar, sir, is a veterinary officer of Aranjana Zoological Park, and he has over 36 years of experience in the field of veterinary science. And sir has also taken care of health management, disease prophylaxis, breeding management, and chemical immobilization of wild animals. And we feel so happy to have you, Dr. Dayashekar, sir. Now the session is over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Dayashekar. I am much thankful for my director and my deputy director to give me a wonderful opportunity to present the urban wildlife. Yeah, urban wildlife. We have had a very good explanatory speak from our Dr. Manimuli and Dr. Ganesh. Regarding the entire scenario of our urban. So urban development is one of the leading worldwide to conserve biodiversity. In the near future, wildlife management in urban landscape will be a prominent issue for our wildlife professionals. Just you can hear a lot of messages from both of our speakers regarding all these things. So I'm specifically in speaking of rescue and rehabilitation. How you can see how much of problem faced by our wildlife, which is venture into a urban area. So we next level is the rescue and the rehabilitation of them. Most of the rescue, the wildlife life of that animal is in most dangerous space. This cannot be recap their life into a live area because their damage is more and more. It is unable to rescue them. In most of the rescue area, we face lot of damages to these animals. So what is the solution? Human has to recognize non-human animals as fellow urban dwellers with a legitimate claim on shared urban spaces. This is the thought of our presence. Once we are able to feel this as a fellow urban dweller, there is a legitimate claim on sharing the urban space to the non-human animals. So most of the area, that this is the major classification, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. This area is the most animals are living in our urban area. Rescues happening in all that area, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. I'm going to focus on that recent rescue operations we have done in Chennai cities, where most of our deer population, that is our axis, that is our spotted deer, is strangled in a pocketed area. Why the strangling happening? Because of the fragmentation of their habitat, natural habitat. They are the natural habitat of this area, but because of the fragmentation, they are unable to move around and they have forced to live in a very controlled or very limited environment. So how that urbanization, buildings, communication towers, roads and highways, landfills and dumpsters, garbage cans, urban introduced invasive feral species. This is one of the recent area where we have to see on that. Urban introduced invasive feral species. So we are we urban people likes to have all the species which has been with us from the other species, that is from exotic species we have, lot of feral species we have. But what is ultimate happening is they are not keeping them with them for their entire lifespan. If some infection or something they want to do, no, they are let loose them inside the environment. That's the another area where we have to look in. So ultimatum is that interspecies sociability. That is the most all human being has to adopt on that. Then only we are able to do with the entire biodiversity in our control. So in India, as India has continued to grow its urban wildlife habitat are shrinking, they are becoming increasingly disconnected from each other, which threatens mobility among the species that inhabited them. So what to do? Create a corridor to facilitate a wildlife movement. We have to be a facilitator to have a corridor to our wildlife, which is the utmost important in our entire ecosystem. I'm only specifically, I want to talk about our access, which is packeted in and around our Chennai city. So they are dwelling places. When we have went there and surveyed for nearly a year, we looked in there. They are garbage. They are eating a garbage. They are looking in. They are stranded inside the building, and they are living like a small threatened area. Some area the human are feeding them like pets. Most of the area we found that it is a garbage and the drainage, and near the Kuom River area, they are taking that all the waters which is not potable for them to drink. This is the area where I want to specify that. This is the plastics which is dumped inside our entire city area. This cannot be happen in a day. It is for our entire lifespan. The animal took this. The plastics cannot go out of their stomach because of their inability to digest. They are mixed with the food materials and they stay there for a long time. This is one of the major threat we faced, and during the postmortem, this is the findings. Nearly 15 kg of plastics we took recently. This is the area where we created a quarantine area, that is from taking from the urban area, these animals' habitat of eating all filthy materials. So this took nearly 15 to 20 days for them to adapt to the green fodder eating, and their behavioral pattern has to be altered from the human dwelling to the natural habitat behavior. After that, we created a specialized vehicle and how we specialized vehicle, which is just like a near nature, and we are able to make that animal pass inside the vehicle as they are living in a near nature. Then we are identified a lot of forest reserved areas where the animal already living. We are able to relocate them. This is the one of the major relocations happened recently in our Chennai city. So you see that there is another threat, which is the perils, which also take killing of our black bears and wild animals. So inside the cities, our governor's palace and our other institutions, we have a lot of black bears and spotted deers, which and we have another urban our forest inside, that is our national forest Gindi. We have a lot of spotted deer and our black bears is living there with comfortability, with all the environment is set in for them to live. So this is a nutshell. I want to say that it's a thank you. We have to keep our urban wildlife as one among our wildlife. We have to give our space for them to live. They are also living animals. They need also space to live. Thank you very much for hearing me. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful session and sharing your interesting rescue journey with us. So thank you so much, sir. Now we are in the concluding part of the 67th Wildlife Week celebration in India, due to which Arindrana Zoological Park has organized several events throughout this week. And with Director Ma'am's permission, I would like to share a gypsum of video clippings, a photograph of the entries that we received through the contest. All the very best for all the contestants who have participated in the Wildlife Week contest. Now, I feel so privileged and happy to welcome our director, Madam Karnapriya IFS ma'am, to present the valedictory note of today's session.
Good evening, everybody. We are here at the end of the week-long Wildlife Week celebration. From October 2nd to October 8th, every year, it is designated as Wildlife Week. The role played by the wildlife in maintaining ecological maintaining the ecological balance is in the nature is undeniable. Any harm to this wilderness or wildlife will pose a great threat to the entire ecosystem. So there is a great need to preserve all the wilderness, all the wildlife, along with its habitat. So this Wildlife Week, celebration was first started somewhere in 1955-57. So from then onwards, every year we've been celebrating this Wildlife Week. During this Wildlife Week, experts are addressed, a lot of conferences are addressed by experts to instill conservation values among the general public and spread the message of conservation and protection of wildlife. A lot of activities are undertaken to send the message of conservation to one and all. Coming to India as such, it has only 2.5% of the world's geographical area, whereas we have 7% of the world's biodiversity. India is a very biodiverse rich country. It has a biodiversity hotspot in the world. It has biodiversity hotspots in the world. The more the biodiversity and the wildlife we have, come with it, the potential threats. So we need to say value and conserve our wildlife and biodiversity. And coming to Tamil Nadu has been in the forefront of protected area management. We have around 7,070 square kilometers of protected area, which is almost roughly 13.9% of our forest area. We have 15 bird sanctuaries with us. We have 15 wildlife sanctuaries, 5 tiger reserves, 2 conservation reserves, and 3 biosphere reserves. So we have the Western Ghats is one of the 3 biodiversity endemic areas in our country. It also has a tradition of enacting laws for various animals. Like we can think of the Tamil Nadu Wildlife, the Wild Elephants Preservation Act. It is prior to coming into being of the Wildlife Protection Act, the present-day Wildlife Protection Act. We also have the Vedantangal Bird Sanctuary, which is one of the oldest bird sanctuaries in the country. It was declared way back in 1936, actually. And we have one of the earliest tiger reserve, which was Mudumalai, which was declared. It was way back in somewhere in 1962, which is 11 years ahead of the coming into being of the Project Tiger. So we have a rich history of protection measures being taken to conserve the biodiversity. Coming to the zoo, we have a lot of zoo. This is one of the oldest zoo in the country, and we do undertake a lot of the zoo education programs to create awareness among the students. Zoos are there for there are lots of importance of the zoos. One, zoos act as breeding areas or conservation areas to multiply populations and reintroduce them into the wild. This is one of the foremost important functions of the zoo. They do act as insurance populations for setting up insurance populations and releasing them into the wild. Third is, a lot of visitors visit the zoo. While visiting the zoo, we help in establishing connection with the nature. So that helps in actually spreading the message of conservation of wildlife to the people and the public at large. So zoos are living museums. What we learn from managing the animals in the zoo can be applied in the field to treat the animals and manage them in their natural environment. So coming back here, as part of the Wildlife Week celebration, a spate of activities to spread the message of conservation have been conducted with the zoo, right from bird watching. We have almost from October 2nd to 8th, we had a list of activities each day happening in the zoo. We had conducted bird watching. There was a painting competition, elocution competition. and we had this zoo or the animal keepers interaction programs, and all these programs are meant to inculcate value of conservation of wildlife and spread the message of conservation and support those who are in this field as pledging their support for the conservation of the wildlife. So with this, I end this note. I end my this thing, and I request each one of you to pledge your support in favor of conservation of wildlife. Wildlife, if wildlife is there, the ecosystems are there. If the ecosystems are there, the entire life on earth is there. So let's save the wildlife and the ecosystems for our own survival. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the enlightening talk. I'm sure that everybody of us will take a pledge today to conserve the wildlife. So I thank our deputy our director, madam, Karunapriya IFS madam, our deputy director, madam, Kanchana IFS, and the speakers of the day, Ganesh sir, Chennai Snake Park, Dayashekar sir, veterinary officer of AAZP, Manimoli sir, biologist of AAZP, for joining today's session. So thank you so much for all. And we will all meet you again in another session in a very short term. Thank you.
I'm very sorry, ma'am.
It's come out well.